Living Lectures, Men of the Profession. A series of seminars with leaders in the fields of environmental management. Presented by the Department of Park Administration, Horticulture and Entomology at Texas Tech University. Professor Elo J. Urbanofsky, Chairman. Dr. James D. Mertis and Mr. Pat D. Taylor, Faculty Coordinators. In the studio is Mr. Horace Albright, retired president of U.S. Potash Corporation and former director of the National Park Service. Mr. Albright served as assistant to Stephen Mather, the first director of the Park Service, and later, upon Mather's retirement, Albright became the second director of the service, serving from 1929 to 1933. Also in the studio are Dr. James Mertis, Mr. Art Glick, and Mr. Pat D. Taylor, faculty representatives of the Department of Park Administration at Texas Tech University. We're here on the campus of the University of California at Berkeley, where our guest, Mr. Horace Albright, is attending the 60th anniversary of his graduating class, the class of 1912. And Mr. Albright, welcome to the Living Lecture.
Thank you, sir.
I'd like to ask you one question to get us started regarding your tenure as director of the National Park Service. You were an assistant to Stephen Mather. When was it that you first realized that you were going to be Mather's successor?
Well, I don't think I realized it until after he was stricken in November 1928. He suffered a stroke and he indicated he wanted me to be his successor. He'd spoken about it before, but I hadn't taken it too seriously. I thought he was good for a good many years, and I wasn't very anxious to be director. I certainly had the experience along that line earlier, and I was well satisfied where I was. But I would say that probably about 1927 is about the first time he mentioned it to me, and which I immediately discarded the idea.
But he mentioned it to you several times.
He mentioned it to me several times when he felt a little tired, or something came up and made him think he had to leave the heavy government work. He mentioned that he knew he had to have a successor, and he thought I ought to be the one.
Right.
Which I always took exception to that, because he had an assistant in Washington, and I wanted to stay in the field.
You were born in Bishop, California, grew up close to the Sierras, and had early days in the mountains. Could you go back and reminisce a little bit of how you became interested in conservation? Build upon this throughout your career.
I thought you were going to ask me how I came to be born Bishop. It was a chance to bring in the old cliche, you would like to be with your mother at a time like this. As a matter of fact, my family were living in Candelaria, where my father was connected with one of the Northern Bell Mine, but they had no doctor there, at least good enough to satisfy the expectant mothers, and so they used to get on the narrow gauge train and come over Montgomery Pass down into California to Bishop, where there was an excellent doctor. And that's what my mother did for her first two children. The first one she lost, I was the second one. And later on, we moved there to California when I was about 4 years old. So I was. That's the way I got to be a native son of California.
But you spent a lot of time, though, those early days.
Well, I was really there in Bishop, and was only out a couple of times before I came here to Berkeley in 1908. It was a very remote country in those days. Nobody knew where it was. Even if you'd studied civics in high school, supposed to know the counties of California, nobody seemed to know. I used to have to carry map in my pocket to show where I came from. I knew nobody would know Bishop, the town I came from, so I mentioned Inyo County, which is about the fourth largest county in the United States. It's something like the size of Massachusetts in size. And usually my inquisitor would say, oh yes, I've been in Indio, which is a little town way down near the Salton Sea. And I have to explain what Inyo County was and take out my map and show where it was. So it was a pretty remote area that I came from.
Well, then you grew up very, very close to the outdoors.
Yes, we were right there at the foot of the Sierra, and we camped in the mountains and fished. It was a paradise for fishing and hunting. I didn't hunt myself, but fishing, I loved the fishing, and in summertime we camped in the hills for a month or so, and we boys, after we got to be 12, 13 years old, could go out by ourselves camping. And by the time I was 14, I pretty well covered the passes and high country of the Sierra just west of us. Mountains are very high there. We could look right out of our dining room window to a peak 13,000 feet. And so I was brought up in a mountain atmosphere, of course. And my family had always been in mountain country. My grandfather was in mining for many, many years, and then in his last years he was in lumber, logging in Shasta County, California. My father was in mining from the time he came out to Virginia City, Nevada on the Comstock load about 1873. So that we were in an atmosphere of the outdoors, of the mountains, of mining, ranching, all that kind of thing.
Let's go back just a little bit further now, perhaps even before you were born, pick up some things of a chronological nature. I think there are probably few people who know as much about the history of the National Park Service as you do. You were there, you know a great deal about the conservation movements in the country. And there's a fellow by the name of Cornelius Hedges that I suppose a lot of people, lay people, don't know, but he's often given credit for being the man who gave birth to the National Park Service idea. Do you think this was true?
Well, I can't say that he gave birth to the National Park idea. He certainly gave birth to the idea of creating Yellowstone National Park. At a campfire at the junction of the Fire Hole and Gibbon Rivers on the 19th of September, 1870. He belonged to what is known as the Washburn-Langford Dome Party, which covered the park on an exploratory trip, and this was their last night in the park, and they were on the campfire. They were talking about what we're going to do with this area, what could be done with this area that they had learned so much about, and there were various suggestions given to as to how it might be acquired, how it might be cut up, how people might get private participation in the ownership of land. And then Judge Hedges spoke up and said that the area was too fine and should be reserved for the public as a national park. And they were big enough and generous and sensible enough to accept that idea. There was no more talk about acquiring any part of it in private ownership. However, there's been a party there before in 1869, known as Folsom Peterson Party, that made a partial survey of the area, and they had mentioned the advisability of preserving it. And they were probably to a great extent inspired the 1870 trip. To that extent, there was a thought given out before. Whether Judge Hedges knew that or not, we don't know. We don't know what extent that little reference of the Folsom party influenced Folsom, Hedges. Mm-hmm. My own feeling is that it was spontaneous on Hedges' part. And there's also been a thought that Yosemite, which was Yosemite Valley, and the big Mariposa big trees were given to the state of California in 1864, that might have influenced it. But there's no evidence that they knew about Yosemite or cared about. Anyway, it wasn't Yosemite was not a national park. Those areas were given to the state. There was no national park in the Yosemite region until 1890. Mm-hmm. So the probabilities are that campfire talk by Hedges it was the beginning of the national parks as we know them.
It must have moved awfully fast because only 2 years later it became a reality.
Well, it did. They were a very fine lot of people, and Mr. Langford, who is the and who wrote up the story of the campfire of the trip of 1870. Well, Lieutenant Doan did too, but he went out to lecture on the area. Gave lectures in the East and wrote two articles for Scribner's Magazine, which were published in 1871. And he stimulated the interest of Ferdinand V. Hayden, who was head of the Hayden Surveys of the geographical surveys of the territories, which were looking into the Rocky Mountain areas, and stimulated Hayden to organize his 1871 party for a look at just at Yellowstone. And he brought along with him two great artists. One was Thomas Moran, who became an exceedingly distinguished artist, and the other was William H. Jackson, the pioneer photographer. And so by the end of 1971, they had much data about the area, and Langford, of course, meantime, had been writing and talking, and they were ready for that time to do something about it. William H. Claggett had been elected to the territorial delegate in 1870, and he was much his territorial delegate from Montana. They interested him, and he put the legislation in, and there were, meantime, two people got very much interested in it, Senator Vest of Missouri, and Congressman Dawes of Massachusetts. They were thrilled by the stories they'd read and the pictures they'd seen, and the bill went through fairly fast. Mm-hmm. It's quite interesting, particularly the people who think that California, on account of the Yosemite Grant, influenced this creation of Yellowstone as the first national park in the world, must realize that, and I think do realize, that there was only one vote against the bill in the Senate, and that was by Senator Cornelius Cole of California.
One vote.
Just one vote. In the Senate. So President Grant signed the bill March 1st, 1872. It's an interesting thing. They were also impressed with the pictures, which were very big pictures, taken by Mr. Jackson. And of course, they were taken on the old plates and had to be carried on a muleback hundreds of miles. Had to be developed as soon as the picture was exposed. And they wanted copies of their own, so I can't find out that the Senate, the House, had such an album made up of the pictures, but the Senate did, and there was an album made up for each senator. The big volume with about 20 pictures in it, of the finest of Mr. Jackson's pictures, and each senator had one of those bound volumes. And I happen to own the volume that belonged to United States Senator John A. Logan of Illinois. They're probably all extant someplace, mm-hmm. but I only know of two or three. Mm-hmm. But they had a good deal to do with the creation of the park. We've got to go back to that Washburn-Langford party and the campfire of September 19th, 1870 at the junction of the Fire Hole and Gibbon Rivers in Yellowstone Park. And that's where it all started.
Where it started. Mm-hmm.
Quite a few years passed between that time and several more parks were established, but a lot of people don't realize we didn't have a park service for a while. Could you go through the events that took place leading up to the passage of the act which actually created the National Park Service? You were quite close to that.
Well, the original Yellowstone Park, established in 1872, was put under the jurisdiction of the Secretary of the Interior because all public lands were under him. And the next park was Mackinac Island in Michigan, which was established in 1879. But the Army wanted it for, they were, I suppose, had some fortifications along the border in those days. They needed it for military purposes, they said, and there were other reasons why they wasn't suitable for a park at the time. So it was surrendered, and the second national park passed out of existence hardly before it had gotten established. There wasn't any more, there were no more national parks created until 1890, when three of them were created in a matter of about 3 days. Sequoia Park first, and General Grant's now part of Kings Canyon Park, were created, I think, September 19th, 1890, and, September 29th, 1890, and on October 1st, Yosemite was set aside. And there were two different groups of people working on it. The Yosemite Park was largely under the influence of people headed by John Muir. And in the case of Sequoia, it was a group in Visalia headed by Mr. George Stewart. The Sequoia was enlarged on the 1st of October. In other words, the first Sequoia Park was much smaller than it is now, and it was enlarged a couple of days later. Then there were no more parks created until 1898 when Mount Rainier was established. They came along several years apart, all put under the Interior Department, because, I say, all public lands were under the Department. The first time there was a big break in that was 1905, when Theodore Roosevelt transferred the National Forest to the Department of Agriculture, under Pinchot. There began an agitation shortly after the Forest Service. The Forest Service was created in 1905. And as a bureau, and then shortly after that began an agitation for a creation of a National Park Service to look after these parks, which were being administered in the Secretary's office, mainly by a very dedicated attorney by the name of Acker, Bertrand B. Acker, who had many other duties performed. This was just a side issue with him, but he'd been concerned with the few parks we had from way back. I think he went to work for the Department of the Interior about the time Yosemite was created. The biggest conservation event of that time was 1908, when President Theodore Roosevelt called the Conference of Governors at the White House. It's still referred to as the Governors' Conference. The subject matter to be discussed was conservation of natural resources. And he not only had the foresters and people interested in wildlife protection, but he also had people interested in resources of minerals and timber and all. He had industrialists there. I remember one of the principal speakers was Andrew Carnegie. One man there, though, spoke of the importance of parks, and that was J. Horace McFarland, a printer in the printing business in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. He was president of an organization called the American Civic Association, which had been established around the turn of the century, and he had been quite influential in saving Niagara Falls. And that's the first place we know of where there was some real agitation in behalf of saving scenery. Hmm. Was it that? At that conference, but he was alone, almost a lone wolf in the fold that day, and nothing much came out of it. But shortly afterwards, he began agitating it, and by the time President Taft came in, he persuaded the president to make a speech at a meeting of the American Civic Association, also send a message to Congress. And bills began appearing in Congress about 1910. To create a National Park Bureau. They didn't call it National Park Service, the Bureau of National Parks. And the author in the House was John E. Raker, a congressman from California. He came from Susanville, in Lassen County. And the promoter in the Senate was United States Senator Reed Smoot of Utah. They've had bills in there in that session of 1910-11, I think, and 11-12. And, of course, that brings us up to the Woodrow Wilson administration, when Franklin K. Lane of California became Secretary of the Interior. And it was in his administration the Park Service was actually created.
So that this has evolved up to where you came in, or in shortly after that.
My coming in didn't have anything to do with the Park Service. I came in with a professor from the university here, do several things, and I mean, I myself was just brought along as a secretary or whatever you want to call him, associate or, I mean, an assistant. What happened was that Mr. Franklin K. Lane, who belonged to a class at the university which is still in controversy, we don't know exactly what class he belonged to. He needed to graduate. He was a special student. And one of our regents, James K. Moffat, after whom our library is named after, our newest library here, was a regent for many years. He contended that Lane belonged to the class of 1886. And some said he belonged to the famous class of 87, which Mr. Mather belonged to. And there was some people even said he belonged to 1888. That's the one that Hiram W. Johnson belonged to. But I don't know that Lane ever claimed a class. I don't ever remember he saying he belonged to any particular class. But in as much as he came in about the time the class of 86 came in, I guess we're willing to let 86 have him. became Secretary of the Interior on March the 4th, 1933. He'd been an Interstate Commerce Commissioner, and he'd been appointed by Theodore Roosevelt, although he was a Democrat. And there are various theories as to how he came to be selected. Now, I don't want you to regard me as being the slightest bit disloyal, because I owe a lot to Mr. Lane. But you can't get away from the fact, if you're a student of conservation history, that he was probably selected to put over the Hetch Hetchy Act. Give San Francisco Hetch Hetchy Valley for a water supply and power. For years, San Francisco had been trying to get the right to use Hetch Hetchy, which is another Yosemite. It was the canyon of the Tuolumne River, whereas the Yosemite is the canyon of the Merced River. And Lane had been city attorney of San Francisco and had put every bit of energy he could into getting approval of that proposal beginning about 1901. He was the candidate for governor, I guess it was 1902, on the Democratic ticket. He was defeated. He was a candidate for United States Senator and was defeated. But he was an outstanding Democrat from San Francisco, an advocate of Hetch Hetchy. But at any rate, he was appointed Secretary of the Interior and took office March 4th, 1933. Parenthetically, I might say that he came in on March 4th, 1933, and San Francisco had Hetch Hetchy on December the 13th, 1933. So it moved pretty fast, whereas for at least 10 or 12 years, they'd made no headway at all. And a man who helped a great deal to bring about that quick despoliation of Yosemite Park was Pinchot. He defected from the side of protecting Yosemite and protecting Hetch Hetchy. He took the position of the utilitarian position that probably San Francisco needed the power and the water, and they'd better turn Hetch Hetchy over to him. And that helped get it through. But Secretary Lane, on the other hand, had ambitions to do things on a larger scale in conservation, and I don't know what all was in his mind when he sent for Professor Adolph C. Miller, who was head of the Department of Economics here. I think they called him Flood Professor of Finance, or Professor of Finance on the Flood Foundation, or something like that. And I had been his reader. I don't know what they call him nowadays in universities, teaching assistants or something, but I was his reader when I was in my graduate year in the law school. And I got along very well with Professor Miller, although he's a very difficult fellow. When I remember when I applied for the job at the end of my senior year, just as I was graduating here 60 years ago, I needed money to go on with my graduate work, and I understood there was a vacancy in this position. I went and asked him about it. And he said that, yes, there was a vacancy, but what made me want it? And I said, well, I need the money. And he said, but you know, people don't stay with me. They don't like me. They don't work for me. And I said, well, I'll work for you. And I said, you don't need to worry about that. He said, well, make sure it's what you think you will. I said, I've got to. I need the money. And if you give me that job as a reader, I'll stay with you. I don't care what you do to me or say to me. I said, I'll stay with you. And he gave me the job, and I did stay with him. So right after the inauguration in March 4th, 1933, Secretary Lane sent for Dr. Miller to come back. He'd known ever since college days. Miller was a man of independent wealth and traveled around a great deal. He'd been a professor at Cornell. He'd taken graduate work at Harvard. He never did have a doctor's degree. He went back, and Lane offered him the position of assistant to the secretary. He had two assistant secretaries. This was a third position. It only paid $2,750 a year. And he said, he told Mr. Miller, if you'll take this place, I'll elevate it socially, at least, to the rank of assistant secretary. You'll have all the opportunities and facilities that come to an assistant secretary if you take this place. But on the other hand, your title will be assistant to the secretary. There'll be certain papers you can't sign because of laws. You'll have to initial them, and they'll go to other people to sign. But I want you to take over the national parks, the Bureau of Education, the territories of Hawaii and Alaska, and the eleemosynary institutions. In those days, the now agencies that are under the Bureau of Health, Education, and Welfare were under the Interior Department. Freedman's Hospital, St. Elizabeth's Hospital, Howard University for colored people, and the Columbia Institution for the Deaf. They were all government institutions under the Interior Department. So Mr. Miller, but he said, the main thing I want you to do is see what you can do about getting a National Park Bureau. Miller had been in national parks. So Dr. Miller decided he'd do it. I call him Dr. Miller. I always did call him Dr. Miller. I'm sure he never had a doctor's degree. He may have had an honorary doctor's degree. But before he left, he said he had a young fellow out here he'd like to bring back with him, and could he do it? And Lane said, sure, you can take him, bring him back. So when he got back out here, it was just before the end of the school year here, college year in 1913. I'd been with Miller all year here, and I'd been appointed assistant in economics for the next year with a promotion of $25 a month. I was getting $50 a month. This was going to give me $75 a month. I was really sitting pretty. I couldn't have won for a better situation. I had for my last year in law was to be assistant in economics, drawn $75 a month. So when Mr. Miller suggested that I go back with him, I wasn't interested. I told him I was well situated and I didn't want to go. Well, he told me the advantages of going back. I'd never been in the East and only been in Nevada and California. And the sooner I got back there, the better. And it would help me if I wanted to study law, although he thought I ought to study economics. I ought to go for an economics professor. And I asked him what the pay would be. Well, he neglected to ask what the job would be or what the pay would be. He said, well, I'll guarantee you $100 a month. Well, I said, I'm in debt, and I've got a little debt doubtness to pay. And he said, well, you take care of that any way you can. I'll help you do that, and I'll pay your expenses to get back there. You go back there as soon as you can, get things lined up for me. So that's how I came to go to Washington. You see, I had no immediate connection with national parks or with the conservation. But he hadn't any more than gotten back there and gotten settled and started to do something when they pulled him into the job of organizing for the Federal Reserve Act. That was the big thing up that particular summer of 1933. And he was taken over by McAdoo, who was Secretary of the Treasury, and he also had the Secretary of Agriculture, David Franklin Houston, who had also been a professor of finance, and Miller. They were together a great deal in working out the Federal Reserve Act. And so he wasn't around the Interior Department very much, which was a godsend to me, because everything they left around there for him to take care of or look into or develop, fell to me. I had a good chance to get into research and meet people around there. And then they gave me a couple of jobs that Miller didn't want anyway, which gave me an opportunity to meet all the executives. They had a little department or division called the Division of Inspection. They had 8 inspectors that went out on to study complaints against people and against projects in the West. For instance, they had a man who, by the name of Lennon, who looked into charges of misappropriation of monies. They had another one, James McLaughlin, who looked into Indian affairs. And James McLaughlin had been superintendent of the Rosebud Sioux Reservation and had been custodian of the Sitting Bull. And he was the biggest, best man on Indian Sign Language, had more expertise in sign language than anybody else. Those men were left to my jurisdiction. I had to go find jobs for them and assign them and send them out and keep track of their movements and their accounts. And when their reports came in, I'd brief them for the secretary and for the bureau chief. Dr. Miller was away most of the year, but when they got the bill, and the bill finally went through, he was made a member of the federal, original governor of the Federal Reserve Board, through the long term, 10 years. And of course, he resigned. Well, I had gone through, I'd gone to night school that year and got my degree, LLB degree in law, and I'd passed the bar examinations in the District of Columbia and in California. I come out here to California to see the girl I was interested in. I wanted to see if I couldn't win her, and I did. I made quite a killing on that trip. I passed the bar examinations and got her, too. But I was ready to leave then, and Will Colby, who was the outstanding mining lawyer and had been instructor here in mining and water law, and I'd taken his courses, and he was close to John Muir. He was secretary of the Sierra Club, and he'd been John Muir's right-hand man. It was then. And he'd told me that he'd like to have me in his office. In other words, I had an opportunity to go in and practice the law. But while I was still back there, Mr. Lane called in Steve Mather, who was also in the class of 1887, same class as Mr. Miller, and offered him this job of assistant to the secretary. And Mather said that he was a businessman. He knew he'd go to jail in no time if he took on any government work. He was very reluctant to do it. He'd help any way he could outside, but he didn't want to work for the government. So Lane said, well, I've got a fellow to help you on that. So he sent for me and put us together. And that was a friendship that began right there and stuck.
That was a long-lasting team, too.
Yeah, I entered the Interior Department on the second day of June 1913, almost 59 years ago, just last week. We could go today, I guess. And Mather came in 21st of January 1915. So I was there about 3 years ahead of him, you see.
Well, there's probably nobody in the country who's in a better position to help all of us understand a little bit more about Mr. Mather. Could you take a few minutes to explain the early years, the problems that faced the Park Service, the Bureau, when Mr. Mather became part of the system?
Well, we'll go back this way about the handling of the parks. Of course, when Congress authorized Yellowstone National Park in 1872, they made no appropriations for it. The first superintendent was Mr. Lankford of the Washburn Lankford Party of 1870. He was appointed the first superintendent. He served for 5 years without any pay and paid his own expenses, but they gave him no money to do anything about the area. And then they appointed another man, Colonel Norris, who served 5 years, and they did pay him something and gave him a little money, and he started the roads. But there was no money to keep out poachers, and they were people that broke up the delicate geyser formations and so forth. The only thing they could do was, they caught him, was to physically throw him out of the area, because Yellowstone is a 100% federal area, the same as the District of Columbia. It doesn't belong to any state and doesn't belong to any county or any city or anything, you see. So then they had three more superintendents, all of whom tried to do something, but couldn't do it without any money. They just couldn't protect the area, and And it was going from bad to worse. And then, so then Congress passed an act authorizing the secretary to call on the military for troops. And in August 1986, Secretary of the Interior called on the War Department to send troops to the park. And they were there protecting the park until 1918, cavalry. That was their main job, was to protect the park. As other parks were created, Yosemite came along next, and Sequoia. As I say, Mackinac didn't really figure as a national park. As the others came along, they called on the military to patrol them. But in the case of Yosemite and Sequoia and General Grant Parks, those three parks here in California, they only had them up in the summertime. They'd come up from Monterey or from San Francisco in the summertime and patrol the parks and try to keep the sheep out. And they were being overrun by sheep. And as the other parks were created, they were, some local fellow was put in charge, and sometimes the Forest Service, nearby Forest Service officer looked after the area. And if the roads were being built as they were in Mount Rainier and Crater Lake, an Army engineer or his assistant helped out in administering the areas. So it was a pretty loose organization all around. They were very lucky that nothing serious happened. They were kept intact, largely because of the surveillance of this man, Acker, this lawyer back in the secretary's office, who took time off from other duties to see to it that they didn't do anything serious to these parks. One funny thing about Secretary Lane, when he came in, the man was superintendent of Mount Rainier Park. His name escapes me at the moment. He was discharged right away, and some local politician wanted the job, and the secretary unfortunately gave it to him and discharged the superintendent. Well, it so happened that this superintendent was discharged. It was a husband of an old girl of the secretary, Lane. He'd gone with her when he lived up in Tacoma. She was apparently quite a sweetheart of his, and so she took after him. And he had to rush around and find some job for her discharged husband. And fortunately we did. They'd passed a law exceeding exclusive jurisdiction over Mount Rainier, and there was a United States commissionership available, which we got her husband appointed to, and which he held all the rest of his life. But it's quite interesting to see what you can do when you fire one of your old girl's husbands. And be careful about that.
In January of 1929, now, you took over as director of the National Park Service. And just a few months later, in October of 29, the country underwent a very serious economic crash. What was the spirit, the philosophy of Congress during the first part of your administration as director? How did this affect you?
Well, I can't say that the Depression affected us too much because we never had any money anyway. The Park Service never did have much money. And we had gone through the Coolidge economy era, and Hoover hadn't extended it to any extent before he ran into the Depression, don't you see? He took office March the 4th, 1929, and the crash occurred in October 1929. So that appropriations were not increased to any extent. But so far as getting new areas and administering the areas, we had normal cooperation. We got about as much done as we probably would under normal circumstances, but we didn't have much money. Mm-hmm. We had quite a lot of things going on. For instance, there was a movement to create three national parks in the east, the Great Smoky Mountains in North Carolina and Tennessee, where Mr. Rockefeller was matching the state money up to $5 million and bought about 500,000 acres there. About 500 square miles, I should say. And then Shenandoah National Park in Virginia and Mammoth Cave in Kentucky. So we had those things to work on, and we got started on historic preservation in taking Yorktown and Jamestown, George Washington's birthplace. We had Hoover's support all along on all. We got the Grand Teton National Park established early in 1929. I guess that was under President Coolidge. And then two or three other areas, and national, we got some national monuments. We moved along, but without any, nothing spectacularly. We had no, we had no money.
But you did have President Hoover's support.
We have President Hoover's support at every turn. He was always a good on our side. And of course, he had his summer camp down in the Shenandoah area, a camp on the Rapidan. Mm-hmm. I was one of the four men who selected that area for him. And he did something down there that few people know about, and that is that they had a terrible drought in the Shenandoah Valley. It must have been about 1931. And he got an appropriation for relief. Nobody ever gives him any credit for doing anything for the poverty-stricken people, but he got a very substantial appropriation for relief, and that's when he ordered the road built, what's now known as the Skyline Drive, down through Shenandoah Park. And he ordered me to have it surveyed, and he allocated money from his relief money to be to have it built with hand labor of these the poverty-stricken, drought-stricken Shenandoah people. Hire their scrapers and their Fresnos and their plows and their and their horses. It used to be a horse proposition, and the farmers themselves. And that's the way that road was started, at least 15 or 20 miles of it was built that way. Mm-hmm. But we were in touch all the time trying to see where we could help. I guess every other agency was too, where we could help this depression situation, looking for jobs and opportunities for employment and to better conditions. And of course, travel in those days was significant, an economical factor. We encouraged travel all the time. He wanted that done, and we did. Encouraged travel to national parks. Not so much for the idea of getting people in the parks or the people having a good time, but just keeping the money rolling along and, and getting having an economic influence when it was needed.
Well, this was an important time, too, in the history of the parks because it does represent an eastward movement, as you've described it. All of a sudden, we've moved from the west now and begin picking up some areas in the eastern United
States. That's right, but that started before my time, you see. That started with Mr. Mather. The first park in the east was Acadia in Maine. And that was set aside as a national monument before the first war. Sieur de Monts National Monument was called because Sieur de Monts was one of the French statesmen involved in the explorations of the New World. And then it was created just as the war broke out because we had so much reference back to Lafayette. Why it was made the Lafayette National Park. So we had that park about 1919, something like that. And some national monuments were created toward the east, but there was a movement to get in the west, and then the bill about 1925 was passed authorizing this investigation for an eastern finding in eastern national parks, and there was a committee appointed. That committee recommended Great Smoky Mountains, Shenandoah, and Mammoth Cave, those three areas, and they were working on them at the time I became director. Even while I was director, we only got one of them finished so we could administer it, and that was the Great Smoky Mountains. The other two were finished after my time. We also worked on the Everglades while I was director. I took a group down and explored the Everglades, but we didn't get the bill through. Ruth Bryan Owen was the promoter of that. She was a daughter of William Jennings Bryan. She was a congresswoman from Miami. But we didn't, we couldn't get it through.
You left the Park Service in 1933. What made you decide at that point to pull out and go into private business?
Well, you see, I studied here at the university economics and in law. I studied, I concentrated on mining and water law under Will Colby. And I had a feeling that while my parents, my grandfather wanted me to be a mining engineer, thought I ought to go on to the Mackey School of Mines at Reno, which had just opened up. Then, of course, we had the Hearst School of Mines here. I didn't think I was temperamentally equipped to be an engineer, and so I thought I'd come near to it if I studied mining law and specialized in that. And so I always had kind of mining in my blood. I mean, I followed mining affairs. And then Mather was a miner, don't you see? Mather was an Borax miner, mm-hmm. and he had mines, and I had been in his mines, and I would go in mines where I had a chance. I mean, it just seemed to be one of the things you'd do, like going to a national park. If you had a chance to go in a mine, you'd go. And I was well acquainted with the Geological Survey and Bureau of Mines people in the Interior Department. And one of my closest friends was Scott Turner, who was still alive. He's 91 years old. He was one of the fellows that survived the Lusitania. I wrote him a letter just a couple of days ago. He was a great friend of mine, so I was sort of attuned to mining, and they discovered this potash bed in New Mexico, and there had never been any potash mining in the Western Hemisphere. This was the first potash deposit, all in the whole Western Hemisphere that had been discovered as a mineable one. The potash was coming from Germany and France, and a little bit in Spain, and there was a mine being opened in Russia. You know, there was a challenge in there, and I hadn't been director but a little while till these people talked to me about considering going with the company. Long in 31 it was. And I said, no, I didn't want to do that. I said, I had this job to do, and I wanted to stay there. I said, well, so it was offered to me several times. And in 1931, I was in Alaska, and I remember when I came back, I got appendicitis up there. And I was up there recovering about a month before I got back from that experience. And I had found another offer to me that would be September 31, to take over this company. It was still in the exploratory stage. They hadn't finished the mine, and they had to build a refinery. And I turned them down, and then again in the spring of 32. But after the election of 33, I wasn't in, they came immediately after me after the election of 33, because they thought possibly I'd be wanting to get out anyway. There'd be a change of administration, and I'd probably be fired even. I would probably be regarded as a Republican. And I don't think I was ever thorough Republican, or as sound a Republican, or as consistent a Republican as my good friend Newt Drury, although I'd always been a Republican so far as I know, although I didn't vote for Woodrow Wilson. But at any rate, they offered me, then made a good offer to me, and after November 1932. And I said this to him. I said, if you can keep this job open another 6 months until after the administration's in, and I see how it goes, I said, I might take it. But I said, I'd like to go through. I want to keep politics out of the Park Service, and I want to be reappointed. I don't want them to appoint a politician. And I might like it, so I want to stay. And I said, well, you can't be sure of me, but I said, you're surer of me now than you ever were if you still want me. If you're willing to go on that kind of a basis, why, we can continue to talk. Otherwise, we better call it a day. That's what I said after the election in 1932. And so I had several things I wanted to do. I wanted to finish up. I was getting into this historical preservation. I was interested with Mr. Rockefeller in the Williamsburg, and we were taking over Yorktown and Jamestown, creating the Colonial National, what's now the Colonial National Historical Park, and George Washington's birthplace. Trying to expand the influence of the Park Service throughout the country. Always had the fear that we were too small, we could be gobbled up by the Forest Service or some other agency, because we just had a few areas, you know, and a limited part of the country. We needed a lot more congressional support. I felt that was one thing that should be done. Then there were things that Mr. Mather had undertaken that needed to be, I thought I ought to try to finish. And I didn't want to go away without having accomplished something. But mainly, I wanted to keep the Park Service out of politics. I wanted to get over that hump of March the 4th, 1933. Well, of course, the man who was appointed Secretary of the Interior and who became my boss was Harold L. Ickes. I don't know how much you know about Harold L. Ickes, but he was proved to be the best Secretary of the Interior I think we ever had, but he was the meanest man that ever sat in the cabinet chair. He was a holy terror of a fellow to work for. Both Newton and I worked for him. We got along pretty well, but he was a great friend of Steve Mather's. They'd been in Chicago in various affairs together, Hull House and civic affairs, belonged to the civic club there, and they he'd been out on a camping trip in Yellowstone where he'd followed my operations. And he said, I used to come around and talk to the campfire. He went around with what's known as Howard Eaton, the Howard Eaton parties. That was as far back as 1921 or 22. Anyway, he asked me to stay. So having asked me to stay, I decided to stay and do everything I could. And mainly, I wanted to get all these historic areas together, bring them together. And we had quite a number of things to do, and he gave me a lot of things that normally wouldn't be under Park Service jurisdiction, like establishing the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps. So I went along having a good time and enjoying the work and accomplished some things, and we were getting along pretty well. But I thought I saw the handwriting on the wall. I thought it'd be just a question of time till he and I had a collision, and it might be pretty disastrous. So I checked up to see whether they still wanted me in the mining business, and they found out they did. And as soon as I could get away, the better. And so after I'd accomplished about everything I was after and got the CCC well underway, and I told them I wanted to leave and take this position, which was executive vice president and general manager and director of the, and a director of the United States Potash Company, and headquarters in New York, mines and refineries in New Mexico. And I set a date in August, and then my next job was to get the secretary to appoint somebody that would keep it out of politics, still follow on the line of keeping it in the range. Well, there's a little story in connection to that because it involves my beloved friend Drury here. Of course, he was chairman. He was running Save the Redwoods League very successfully, and he had a young, growing family. And secretary wouldn't take my recommendation. I recommended my assistant, A.B. Kammerer, who had been Mr. Mather's assistant, because he was familiar with the situation there in Washington. It was very complicated with so many emergency laws going through and so much money being made available, and you had to know how to spend it. And it was a very difficult situation all around, and I thought that Cam could take hold of it quicker than anybody else. And the secretary wouldn't take my judgment. I remember he made a statement that I never forgot. He snarled at me and he said, I hate the lockstep of civil service. And that's the word he used. Well, I defended the civil service. I'd have to tell you a little bit about how I put the Park Service, because nothing in the Park Service was in civil service for many years. Mr. Mather got the Rangers in under civil service in 1925, and I got the superintendency in 1931. But so we did have a complete Secret Service set up. Well, just as he said, go ahead and call your advisory committee together and see what they think. Somebody that succeeds you. I don't want to put a politician in myself. Well, we had an advisory committee. It was informal. It didn't have any official standing like the present advisory board does. And Dr. J.C. Merriam was on it, and Dr. H.C. Bumpus, and Dr. Osler of New York, and Dr. Atwood of Clark University, and one or two others. So I got them all to come on a certain day, and just as we convened in my office, I got called to the White House on a CCC matter. They hadn't been there 5 minutes in the office. Hardly enough for me to tell them what they were there for. And I was gone all morning. I got back afternoon, but they were still there waiting for me to come, and they had unanimously recommended Newton B. Drury to succeed me. Well, of course, I made it unanimous, but I did say I didn't think Newt would take it. I said, I don't think he can afford to take it at this stage of the game, and if I were in his place, I wouldn't take it. But I said, I'm very glad to go along with him. He's my classmate, and I admire him tremendously, and he can do the job, but I said, I just don't think you'd get him. Well, he said, would you put it up to the secretary? I said, I would. So I did, and the secretary said, I guess we'll have to get some political influence. I said, we'll get Hiram Johnson. I said, he knows him. His brother's son was a classmate of ours. Well, he was still alive then. He committed suicide afterwards, but that boy was still alive.
Mr. Albright, I hate to interrupt, but unfortunately, we're
running
out of time.
Well, anyway, I'll just say that the Newt turned down. Just I thought he would, but he, about 7 years later, he accepted it when Mr. Cameron had to leave.
There's one thing that we'd like to say on this tape, and that was a quote from John Ice's book entitled Our National Park Policy. And he said about Mr. Albright, succeeding a man of Mather's genius, energy, personality, and private wealth was something of an undertaking. But Albright was quite equal to it. Mr. Albright, thank you for being with us on The Living Lecture.
Thank you for the opportunity. I'm very glad to meet all of you, and enjoyed being with you.
This has been Living Lectures, Men of the Profession, a series of seminars with leaders in the fields of environmental management, presented by the Department of Park Administration, Horticulture, and Entomology at Texas Tech University. Professor Elo J. Urbanowski, Chairman, and Dr. James D. Mertis and Mr. Pat D. Taylor, Faculty Coordinators. Produced with the cooperation of KTXT Television.